TheDailyMass.com. Experience the Roman Catholic Mass from historic St. Louis Cathedral every day on TheDailyMass.com. His love, anywhere in the world.
I'm Sarah McDonald.
And I'm Jason Angelet. Welcome to Issues in Faith.
Well, we are at the end of graduation season.
Yeah.
But every year in the Archdiocese of New Orleans, that means it's time to ordain our new priest.
Yes, very exciting time. Wonderful priests, or soon-to-be priests, are being ordained coming up very soon. And so what a beautiful time, a springtime for the church in New Orleans.
It really is, and we're very blessed here in the Archdiocese lately to have had classes that are growing. We have, 2 weeks ago, we had 5 men ordained to the transitional diaconate, which is their final step, not their final step in formation, but one of the concluding steps of formation. They'll be ordained to the priesthood next year, and Saturday, mm-hmm. we will have 4 men ordained to the priesthood here. They have been profiled in the Clarion Herald. I encourage everyone to not only pray for these men, but to read about them, learn about them, and as they take on their new assignments, which they already have, to welcome them into their parishes and to offer prayerful support and temporal support. Offer that just you're doing a good job, or because it is just like it's in marriage. You have that period of learning one another, mm-hmm. learning about one another, learning to live your sacrament. The same thing happens for men who have entered the priesthood or women who have entered the religious life. There is that honeymoon period,
mm-hmm.
and there's also the challenges that come with being a newly ordained priest. So they need the community support throughout their priesthood, but especially now. And so we are very encouraged by our growing numbers of men discerning the priesthood. We have the House of Discernment for Men open. We talked about last week the House of Discernment for Women. Our classes at Notre Dame Seminary for not just the Archdiocese of New Orleans, but the surrounding Louisiana dioceses throughout the province are growing. We are incredibly encouraged by people answering God's call in a vocation to the priesthood or religious life. And we're seeing worldwide, the number of seminarians is growing.
Praise God. And there's something so important, as you said, to pray for them, to pray for our seminarians, to pray for our future priests, to pray for our current priests, our current pastors in the faith, to help us to their journey. Their journey needs to be supported by God's grace and by God's love, and also to encourage our own brothers in Christ to ask if they've been called, if God's calling them to the priesthood, and to always, whatever sacrament or whatever vocation God has called them to encourage them to be faithful to that in every stage, because we're all called to holiness. We're all called to be a faithful husband, a faithful father, and that hopefully, Lord willing, that Lord my children, Lord willing, might one day be called to maybe the religious life, or maybe my son might be called to the priesthood. But in either case, they're all called to be holy, and so that means that I need to take seriously my sacrament. And these great men that are coming into to be a priest and to be shepherds in the faith, they're coming into an important part where their faithful walk as a priest will encourage and strengthen and feed and shepherd the lives of so many souls. So what a wonderful time, so exciting, and we definitely want to, and I think to encourage the faithful to every day, every night before we go to bed, just to say one little prayer, maybe one little prayer extra, to pray for our priests, pray for our religious, and pray for the future of the church.
That's right. And what's also very interesting is that we have different people, men from different walks of life. We have several young men who went straight from high school into St. Joseph's Abbey and Notre Dame Seminary, and others who have taken a longer road mm-hmm. to the priesthood. God does not, time is a human earthly construct. God does not work on our times, on our time frames. So it's important for men of any age and women of any age to be open to God's call and consider to keep looking. Yeah. Just like we are called, as you were mentioning, in our vocations to marriage, to be faithful to our spouses and our children and to God and live with grace. All of us are constantly called to find that grace. And so I want to offer our prayerful congratulations to the 4 men being ordained. thank their families and their support.
That's true.
Their support bases for everything that they have done for them, because you know, seminary, being a seminarian is not easy. It's challenging, mm-hmm. and so you know, their support bases are so important to them as they go along the journey. And to also thank Archbishop Amen for his
Amen.
Very strong support of increasing local vocations, and for always being there for the seminarians and his brother priests.
Praise God.
Within the Archdiocese of New Orleans. Well, as we kick off their summer months, we're going to take a real look back of our school year. Jason sits down with our new superintendent, Dr. Jan Lancaster, for an update.
Dr. Jan Lancaster, thank you so much for being with us. Such a exciting news has been going on. A lot of work that your office is in, you leading the troops. But first, tell us, this has been your first year through. So tell us, how has it been for you personally on this journey?
Well, as I said, when the Archbishop asked me to serve as superintendent, this has been a dream come true.
Praise God.
And this year, just working with so many dedicated people, dedicated to Catholic education and to the ministry of Catholic education, it's really been an honor and privilege. What I've done this year is I've gone around to several of the schools and the parishes, and I've been able to meet with people and just talk to people.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah.
I love going around seeing the neat things. I mean, seeing Catholic education in action, walking around the halls, seeing the smiles, and seeing kids being treated in a very sacred way.
Yeah.
That's what's so important. And the education that's going on there, and the passion for Catholic education, it has just been amazing what I've seen as I've gone throughout the Archdiocese.
Well, praise God. And so recently there's been a lot of meetings, town hall meetings, strategic planning committee meetings taking place. You've been going all over. What has that been like for you?
Well, you know, my first year as superintendent and then having the strategic plan, there's been a lot going on.
Sure, yeah.
But the town hall meetings, I don't know if you know the history of the strategic plan.
Go ahead.
But basically, when I came on board, we were working with Dr. John Convey and Dr. Len DeFury out of Catholic University. And what they're doing, they are coming into the Archdiocese and have been here really almost 2 years, looking at our Archdiocese as an external consultant and letting us know what we need to do to ensure the future of Catholic education. They're focusing on four components. They're focusing, number one, Catholic identity.
Amen.
They want us to, they're looking at our strong curriculum, then also the viability, and then the financial feasibility of our schools. And basically, our vision and our mission in Catholic schools is to be authentically Catholic, striving for academic excellence, and then remaining affordable for people that really want a Catholic education. So with that in mind, they've come into our schools, they've talked to a lot of people, and then most recently, we've had these town hall meetings. The town hall meetings have been very interesting because they're throwing ideas and suggestions out there to kind of just run them by people and get opinions and get feedback. And that's been interesting, just hearing the different ideas. And then also, people have been calling me and emailing me, and I welcome that.
Yes.
I forward all those ideas to John Convey because the plan is only going to be as good as the number of people that participate in the ideas and suggestions. And through the process, we've really gotten great ideas and suggestions. And what it tells me is that people are passionate about Catholic education. And that's a wonderful thing to see.
Yes, indeed.
People, I couldn't believe the number of people who came to the town hall meetings and the wonderful ideas that they had. So I think the future for Catholic education is very bright, and I think this process is validating that.
What I see is so important. I saw this when we met in Mary Queen of Peace, when you were the principal there, and we were just getting introduced to the school. And it was so impressive for us, my wife and I, when we saw you come in, that you met us and you welcomed us, and you welcomed our children. And it was such a conversation that really helped me to realize that you care enough to not just see us as a potential prospect for the school, but as someone who is here to be formed in the faith and to grow. And so, I can just imagine you taking that across the board, and how important it is too for parents to be able to come to these places, these meetings, and to talk to you about their concerns and their cares about what they want to see. And how important is that for their involvement for your process?
Well, first of all, I thank you for your nice words.
Oh, praise God.
Being principal at Mary Queen of Peace, it was so important to me that everyone on that campus was treated in a very sacred way. And like I said, as I go around to the schools, I see that.
Yeah.
I see principals striving for every child to have their needs met to the best of our abilities and being treated as the sacred people that they are. So that really is something that I want us to feel throughout the Archdiocese at all of our schools.
Right.
And I think the town hall meeting the town hall meetings have validated that to some, but we also are looking at concerns and challenges that we're having. Some of the challenges that we're having are the finances of Catholic schools. The finances of Catholic schools, the grade level configuration that we have.
Sure, right.
And then we're also looking at something that is going to be so difficult, but the consolidation of schools.
Yeah.
And letting people know in a spirit of transparency and collaboration what the process
right.
is, what we're doing, why we're doing it.
Yeah.
And right now on our Office of Catholic Schools website, we have the data and information that was presented at the town hall meetings.
Mm-hmm.
So anyone who wants to see the data, if they go to the Office of Catholic Schools website, they can see that.
It's so important to, like you said, to be clear about everything and to show, put all the cards on the table, like this isn't some surprise, we're working together, your input is valid, and we want to do this together, we don't want any surprises. So what we're about to wrap up, but what are some of the things that you're going to walk away with from at this point now, from all the I guess, looking at everything now, and then going into the future?
Well, I think what we're going to do now is we're going to look at people's suggestions. And from those suggestions, recommendations will be made. And then we'll take those suggestions, and the Archbishop will see those suggestions. And he's not seen anything yet,
yeah.
but he's going to look at that probably the end of June.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'll go from there, and we'll formulate a plan for the implementation.
Well, Dr. Jan, thank you so much for being with us. Thank you for all the work that you're doing. It's been an amazing 1 year, and so we just hope and pray for more successful years with us in the Archdiocese.
Well, it has been an exciting year, and working with this Archbishop, he's so committed to Catholic education. So we are very lucky to be in the place where we are now in Catholic education.
Praise God. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And we'll be right back.
What will the world ask of them? Whatever it is, they'll be prepared to answer. Because in a safe and disciplined environment, Louisiana Catholic schools shape tomorrow's leaders. Catholic students are rising. 99% graduate. Almost all go to college. They'll earn higher wages, be community involved, more tolerant of diverse views. And the world will be better because of them. Louisiana Catholic schools, in a class of their own.
Heart of Woman's New Life Center is its outreach to women in unplanned pregnancies, especially those who are seeking an abortion. Our professional counseling services, combined with free ultrasound tests, provide each woman with the nurturing she needs while also revealing her unborn child to her. For more information about the life-saving work of Woman's New Life Center, call 504-831-3117 or visit womansnewlife.com.
I'm here today inside historic St. Louis Cathedral, a place where WLAE has broadcast the daily Mass for more than 25 years.
A recent PBS ruling ensures that this valuable service will continue on WLAE for those looking for daily inspiration, and for the many who are homebound or in our area hospitals who can't attend Mass. But in order to continue to provide the Mass every day, we need your financial support now more than ever. I'm asking you to please consider donating today. We have numerous partnership opportunities available. For as little as $32 a month, you can help fund the televising of the Daily Mass, a program that lifts the spirit and enriches the lives of so many of our viewers. And for a donation of $50 or more, we will send you this beautiful signed poster of St. Louis Cathedral as our gift. Please send your contributions to WLAE-TV, 3330 North Causeway Boulevard, Metairie, Louisiana, 7002, or to donate online, log on to WLAE.com and click on the picture of St. Louis Cathedral. For more information on partnership opportunities, call 504-866-8255. 7411.
At WLAE, we've worked hard to keep the Mass on the air. Now we need your financial support to keep it going. I know that you'll help us if you can. Thank you, and God bless.
As the students at De La Salle High School were finishing up their exams, a party for a long-term teacher was just getting started. As of this year, one of their own has been there teaching for 50 years, and the other teachers and staff and even former students didn't want to let this milestone pass without a party. Janet Gross takes us to a half a century celebration for Dr. Warren Kerr.
The De La Salle Jazz Ensemble helped kick off the party for Dr. Warren Kerr, a teacher, a friend, an inspiration. He's seen and remembered a lot of faces over his half-century career at De La Salle.
Well, it's a long time, you know. But, you know, when you put it together, it passes fast. And then you have, I think it was like six presidents and something like 9 or 10 principals and, you know, umpteen teachers.
About 800 teachers and staff, and he's crossed paths with more than 9,000 students, and he doesn't want to stop. They don't want him to either. In fact, it seems hard to come up with enough glowing adjectives.
So warm-hearted and a fantastic educator, as much as strict as he is, and as hard as he is on his students, he's never cross, never mean, very easygoing, he's just fantastic, like very warm-hearted, not a mean bone in his body, he's just incredible.
Dr. Kerr is the most loving man on earth. He's basically a saint in my book. I've never seen him get upset with anybody. He's always there for you.
Describe the atmosphere and the heavens, which is referring to astronomy. They will talk about the rising stars.
Classrooms change, technology's different, but his love of teaching and reaching students remains the same.
I always use the cartoon of Garfield. He's holding a Christmas ornament, looking at the tree, and he sees where he wants to put this ornament, so he says, ha ha. And so every year when I start school class with him, I make him color a picture of that, because that's the moment that you really enjoy when a student understands and says, ah, understand it. And it's a real satisfaction when that happens, you know.
Originally, he wanted to become a priest. When he realized that wasn't his path, he asked God for direction.
And I consider it divine intervention when he was a graduate student waiting for the streetcar in front of Tulane University, and a brother, Camillus, struck up a conversation with Dr. Kerr. So he talked him into following him, getting on the streetcar right then and there, following him to De La Salle High School.
He got a contract that day and began a career of influencing others.
A gentilhomme, he is a gentleman. He really fits the bill of what St. LaSalle wrote about when he started the Brothers, and he was writing about what a teacher should be like. Doc is calm, he's patient, he's very loving.
Somebody told me the other day, when they look at him, they see the face of Jesus. And to me, that was the best compliment I think anyone can give. And he really is. It's almost like he's a saint walking down here on earth. And we're lucky enough to have him.
He's taught Latin, French, English, civics, worked with wrestlers, retreats, honor society, and alumni. He's always been there for them.
Please help me thank the man who I simply call, again, the nicest man I've ever known, Dr. Warren F. Kerr.
And on this night, they were there for him. I'm Janet Gross for Issues in Faith.
Dr. Kerr has no plans to retire. His students can expect to start with a new Garfield cartoon when school starts in August.
The grief and loss resulting from an abortion can be overwhelming. Many women and men need a safe place to heal. The Woman's New Life Center is that place. We treat each woman and man with the utmost respect and dignity. We offer individual counseling and referrals to post-abortion retreats that offer a psychological and spiritual approach to healing. Call 504-831-3117 or visit womansnewlife.com.
We never forget our best teachers, the ones who do so much more than teach. They inspire and insist we bring our best in everything we do. We find those mentors in our Catholic schools. It's why Catholic school graduates consistently go on to college, land better jobs, embrace faith, and lead. Louisiana Catholic Schools, in a class of their own.
When a whole lot of ducks get together, there are different ways to describe them. A paddling, a team, a brace, a raft, and of course, a flock. But when 15,000 of them, all wearing sunglasses, gather on Bayou St. John, it's called nothing but fun. Janet Gross takes us to the Duck Derby with a cause.
The Rubber Duck Derby, $5 a duck, a quack pack, it's a deal.
Thousands of rubber ducks racing down the bayou. Even in New Orleans, we don't do this all the time. But once a year, for a good cause, you bet.
We're dumping 15,000 ducks out of a dump truck. So right there in of itself, that's something to see, the ducks hitting the water. And then once they hit the water, the firemen turn the hoses on. And so you've got hoses coming from three directions, hitting the ducks and pushing them towards the finish line. The finish line is actually a tube. And so the first duck through the tube wins.
Yeah, you really got to get the fire department in on this, because here on Bayou St. John, there really isn't much of a current. A lot of kayaks, no current.
The dump truck's going to dump the ducks into the bayou. We got this fire truck here. We're going to squirt them and push them away from the dump trucks. And then we're going to take engine 26 here, the other pumper. We're going to take two lines off of it and put them on the other side over there and push them all in, push them this way.
So while the hoses were prepared, all bets were on.
$5 gets you in the race.
We missed it last year by like an hour, but so this year we're really excited to come see it. My son's been bugging me all day.
I'm buying two ducks.
Why?
I'm buying two ducks because I want to win a car.
You know, this also goes to help.
Oh yeah, I want to help people too, but I want to win a car.
I bought six for $25. It goes to a good cause, and I want to win a car.
And they're off. Well, most of them, with all those new car dreams bobbing in the bayou. While it's funny enough just to do it for laughs, there is actually a good cause behind this duck derby at Bayou Boogaloo. All proceeds go to support Second Harvest Food Bank.
Second Harvest Food Bank, of course, was formed with the Archdiocese. Archbishop Hannon helped form Second Harvest Food Bank many years ago. Over 25 years ago, and we're still a proud member of the Archdiocese. We do operate independently, but we love our common history with the Archdiocese and that linkage back to that social justice issue.
This fun really helps out in the summer. A lot of kids are left hungry when they can't get those subsidized school lunches. So these rubber ducks are really paying off as donors dream of what ducks can do.
It's a duck, why not? $5, better than the lottery chances. You put a dollar for the lottery and you can't win unless you get struck by lightning. Put a duck in the pond, you never know who they're gonna push.
They needed a little help in the final push to the finish, but in the end, the winner netted a new car. And then the National Guard netted the racers. And Second Harvest netted the funds to help feed the hungry. So here, everyone met their goal of keeping their head above water. I'm Janet Gross for Issues in Faith.
This is the third annual Rubber Duck Derby for Second Harvest. It's been a big hit and a big fundraiser for them. The money they raise helps feed the more than 260,000 needy people in South Louisiana.
If you have a question for us, an idea that you'd like to see on air, please write to us at Issues in Faith, 3330 North Causeway Boulevard, Suite 345, Metairie, Louisiana, 7002. Or you can email us at questions@wle.com. Plus, if you miss an episode, you can catch up online at www.archdiocese-no.org.
And that's our program for this evening. For all of us at Issues in Faith, thanks for watching and have a great summer.
God bless.